Today's scripture from the Old Testament is number 6, verses 13 through 20, and page 123 in your Bible if you'd like to follow along. Now, this is the law of the Nazarite when the period of their dedication is over. They are to be brought to the entrance to the tent of meeting. They are to present their offerings to the Lord, a year-old male lamb without defect for a burnt offering, a year-old ewe lamb without defect for a sin offering, a ram without defect for a fellowship offering, together with their grain offerings and drink offerings and a basket of bread made with the finest flour and without yeast, thick loaves with oil, olive oil mixed in, and thin loaves brushed with olive oil. The priest is to present all these before the Lord and make the sin offering and the burnt offering. He is to present the basket of unleavened bread and is to sacrifice the ram as a fellowship offering to the Lord, together with its grain offering and drink offering. Then at the entrance to the tent of meeting, the Nazarite must shave off the hair that symbolizes their dedication. They are to take the hair and put it in the fire that is under the sacrifice for the fellowship offering. After the Nazarites shave off the hair that symbolizes their dedication, the priest is to place in their hands a boiled shoulder of the ram and one thick loaf and one thin loaf from the basket, both made without yeast. The priest shall then wave these before the Lord as a wave offering. They are holy and belong to the priest, together with the beast that was waved and the thigh that was presented. After that, the Nazarite may drink the wine. Thank you.
Now from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 5 through 15. So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to go on ahead to you and arrange in advance for this bountiful gift that you have promised, so that it may be ready as a voluntary gift and not as an extortion. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. The one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed, for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. The rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ, by the generosity of your sharing with them and with all others. While they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you. Thanks be to God for this indescribable gift. For this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So most of you have probably seen the videos that we showed in worship the past couple Sundays. And a thank you to Jackie and Jerry Clement for making those possible, and Taste and for also contributing. We're grateful for those. But in Jackie's video last week, she made the comment about the garden. This kind of spoke to me, and hopefully you guys kind of remember that instance of it too. But, you know, if you have a garden, you kind of need to annually till the soil, sow more seed, and then harvest the fruits or vegetables or the dead plants that I seem to always grow in my gardens. And so it's an annual exercise that we have to do with the garden. The same goes for a church. Annually, we'll have a stewardship campaign or a moment where we need to recommit our financial gifts for the following year. And that's not possible without all of you gardeners to help with that. And we're very grateful for give to the church financially and time-wise and resource-wise. But there's so many things that go on in the church that need those finances to continue that we should highlight some of these. We have Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts that meet here during the week. There's Al-Anon, Meals on Wheels, Women Study Groups, and Buddy Break that meets Saturdays once a month. On top of that, we have the preschool ministry, and so many other families and children, their hearts are touched and reached through the preschool that takes place every day for weeks on end. And then we have other positive ministries that support local food banks or local charities that make a big difference in Winter Springs, Oviedo, the greater Central Florida area, going next week to do daily bread. We have this building that houses so many of those groups that needs upkeep itself and just time to spend and invest in the time of those groups and the building itself. So like I said, with that, we need you. The giving that you provided goes such a long way to help making all of this possible, that each year we've got to till the soil, replant some new seeds, and re-harvest the fruits that we might grow. So with this, there's a book that I read recently, or at least kind of parts of it. One is called The Giving Heart, but there's one called The Giving Tree by Shel Silverstein. Have you guys read that book? Yeah, it's one of my childhood favorites. If you've read it, you're probably familiar with it. If not, I'll highlight a little bit. Don't worry, it's not a long book. It's only like 20 pages or so. And it's supposed to be pictures, which is maybe why I like it so much. But it starts out with this tree. This young boy, small, kind of grows up and says, you know, tree, how are you doing today? I'd like to do something for fun. He's like, well, you can climb my trunk and go up and climb and have some fun. And the tree provided some shade with its branches for the young boy. And the boy eventually carved the heart from the tree, saying the giving tree plus the boy is a love thing. So that was a mark. The giving tree was happy to provide these services. And it's time for this cute little boy. Eventually the boy grows a little bit older. And you know, as grown men, we don't climb trees as often. Some make a profession out of it, but we don't do it as much anymore. So the older boy, as a man, comes back and says, I don't need to really climb your trunk anymore. I don't need to climb the tree. But I'm building a house. Can I have your branches? Giving tree says, sure. Here, take some branches. So he cuts some branches down. He uses them to build a nice little house for the boy, for the man and his family. Eventually, the man gets a little older, comes back to the tree that now is branchless, just a big, long trunk. He says, I'd like to go somewhere. I'd like to make a boat. So, well, you can have my trunk. Here. So he cuts the trunk down, carves out a boat, and sails off somewhere on an adventure. And then eventually comes back, and the tree is now just a stump. And I said, well, I don't really have much left to give you. So that's okay, I can just sit on you. So he sits on the stump. So that's where the story pretty much ends. I know it's anticlimactic, but that's how we end up. So the boy says, the story is that, you know, you got two main characteristics and traits that exist in this story of the giving. You got generosity, right? Offering the tree, the branches for shade, and all of that, and then sacrifice. The tree gave its branches, gave its whole trunk for this man, this boy, and his life. And I feel the same can be said for God. God is extremely generous, and God is also sacrificial. We have Jesus Christ, God's one and only Son, that came and died for us willingly on the cross, a huge sacrifice, giving up your life. For people, we admittedly don't deserve that. We didn't do anything to earn that favor or earn that grace or that love or that generosity. And yet Christ still died for us. The same way God is generous throughout Scripture, you see all these generous moments. It's time to just be a generous person or to see God being generous to someone else. Offering grace, forgiveness, mercy, love, kindness, joy to people, and abundance. The same goes for us. We receive this generosity through the promise of eternal life, right? So grace, or generosity, and sacrifice kind of going hand in hand. And I feel God wants us to be a generous person, and to be kind and giving and loving in our hearts. See, God was generous and sacrificial. Maybe God calls us to do the same. But truly building and generating this kind of giving heart is no easy feat. It's hard. Now, some of us might be born with it. Just come out of the womb with our twin brother and say, here, you can have my blanket. I'm a generous person. For others, we have to cultivate the generous and giving heart. It's not easy. It takes a challenge. It takes some time. But this a book I read titled The Giving Heart by M.J. Ryan has some key components to how you can develop a generous and giving heart. Some of this is my own little thought or knowledge into the situation. So I'll highlight three different things. So the first one we have is up on the screen. So the way you can generate a giving heart is every day you wake up and think of a random act of kindness you can do for someone that day. Now that's giving you kind of cold sweats off. Think, Pastor, every day I've got to wake up and think of doing an act of kindness. But that's too much. Scale back to it maybe once a week, or at minimum once a month, right? And we'll find out that, you know, you can get, kind of grow and nurture this heart that becomes a little more kind and generous to other people. But it doesn't always have to be finances. That can help. You can go through a drive-thru, pay through for someone's meal that's behind you. And that's one way to pay. Another way is a video that my wife posted to her social media accounts this week. That's his mom, and she has two young children, or kind of one's maybe a teenager, another maybe 8 or 10. And 2 hours a week, they'll go out and drive around town and see different ways in which they can do a random act of kindness. And one way was going to the laundromat and giving someone some change to dry and wash their clothes that day. But again, it doesn't always take money. Another one that they did I thought was great, they went to a local grocery store like Publix. You know how they always have those stray shopping carts out and about? Just wandering around, like they get out of their cage and think they're fancy free and just having fun in the parking lot. Well, they went and collected them all and put them back where they belong. Does that take time? Yes. Does it take money? No. Is someone in that Publix paid to do that job? Of course. But that doesn't negate the act of kindness. Imagine the joy on their face when they come out and expect to collect all these shopping carts and their job's already done. Or the person is trying to park in their parking space and they don't have to worry about nicking or hitting their car with a parking cup. The car is taking up that space. So you can do acts of kindness in different ways other than just monetary and, you know, different kind of words or thoughts or actions with that. So the next one I want us to highlight is the acts of kindness can kind of lead to our next component. Do you have the next slide? There you go. Okay, there we go. Generosity is the mother of kindness. Now, this is a direct quote from author Ryan's book. And she writes that our desire to give, to help, comfort, support, or appreciation is often the reason we do kind things. Now, furthermore, in reading and talking and thinking about generosity, author Ryan realized just how important it is. So we tend to think of generosity as volunteering our time or giving money, but it's actually much broader than that. It comes in all shapes, forms, and sizes. Immaterial, intellectual, emotional, and spiritual. But we can be generous when we give our knowledge, our awareness, our empathy, or our silence. But generosity is also about letting go of grudges or hurts, concepts of ourselves and the world that may stand in our way in connection to other people. So you see, generosity really is the mother of kindness. But having this thought, this mentality, this attitude that we should give to others or give to certain functions or organizations, then we can develop a kinder heart as well. But through these actions, and not just monetarily, but as author Ryan mentioned, but through giving up grudges or hurts or pains, by listening to people, by being attentive, by offering our time, our ears, our eyes, our hearts, we can be a little more kind. That's how our generosity grows. That's how this kindness also develops. We enact it through sharing our wisdom. Sharing our ears, sharing our attentiveness, sharing our time with those around us. And having that generous thought and that generous heart will eventually lead to us being a kinder person. Just like how So another pertinent point that Author Ryan makes is, you know, how you can have this attitude in life and how it really shapes who you are and how you kind of see the world. But she states that for some of us, such attitudes are innate. Where they were taught to us when we were so young, they just seem second nature for us now. But for others of us, these attitudes may require some rethinking of our fundamental assumptions about life. And here's one key point she writes. Does attitude support behavior? I'll say it again. Attitudes support behavior. So we behave in certain ways when we believe certain things. So if we change our mind, we change our lives. All it takes is the willingness to change. It's a matter of figuring out what brings us true contentment. Whether it's believing there's not enough to go around in the world, so we hold on to tightly to what we have or what we know. Or whether it's trusting that we are as open and we can be open at our hearts to ourselves and to other people. And then by doing so, our love will be replenished that. But not just by keeping it all to ourselves, but by sharing it with other people. The sense of fulfillment and contentment comes from sharing our gifts with others. You see, that's just it. Frequently, our attitudes influence our behaviors. If we feel that we are a generous person, we should be a generous person, we see optimism in the world, and that'll shape how we act. It'll shape how we behave. It'll shape who we are. And so we see the world as someplace that's out to get us. Something that should be dangerous or we shouldn't care for at all, we just lock ourselves up in our room, stay isolated, and do away with generosity, do away with kindness, and live on our own. But these attitudes, the way we see things, the way we see the world, the way we see other people greatly influences how we act. So we have to see others as people that deserve our kindness. The people that deserve our generosity. I know I see to my children from time to time. I love it. My heart gets warmed anytime I share a toy or something with another friend. But of course, naturally, one does it better than the other. I guess she gets that from me. No, but they're born, someone just born with this attitude of generosity. And it really makes them a kinder child and person. They see the world with these innocent and loving eyes. They see this world in which stuff is meant to be shared. Their hearts, their time is meant to be given to other people. And it makes them happier, makes me happier because of it. Our research has actually shown that when we give, when we're generous of our time, our ears, our talents, our money, we really are a happier person. There's no way to pinpoint how or exactly why that happens. Just know that it does. Our generosity, which begets kindness, can make us a better person. We can be better for it. You see, I feel the one thing that impedes us from generosity so much is something that I've hinted at recently. It was those fears. A fear that we don't know what tomorrow brings. A fear that maybe our thoughts or our savings will run out. Fear that we don't know what lies around the next corner, or when tragedy may strike our life or someone else's life. Again, that goes back to our attitude. It's how we see the world. But do we see it as a place of fear? Or do we see it as a place to flourish and be generous and kind and love? You see, I feel God was onto something when He called the early followers and the early people of God, and even us later in the New Testament, to give and sacrifice. The two tricks of God in the giving tree. A God knew how happy it would make people to give, how much more they would appreciate life, their situation, the blessing that they have in their own life when they were called to give as in numbers, an unblemished ram or a ewe or a lamb. A giving sacrifice for their family. They gave up a lot when they gave those gifts. It could be another meal for them. But God knew that that would make them a kinder, more loving, and appreciative person. So I feel that God calls us to do the same. You see, sadly, we're gripped in a world that's just traumatized and held afraid to go outside, afraid of what the next day brings, or afraid of the next news story we may hear over the airwaves, or afraid of what our life may entail, or what choices we've made, or what things we've done. There's a great deal of fear that kind of goes about. But if our attitude changes, if we don't see the world as a fearful place, we can see the good in the world. Which brings me to my last slide. So believe there is good in the world. So if you believe there is good in the world, then we'll act much differently towards it. And you see the little yellow highlighted words? Amidst the belief there is good in the world, you are to be the good in the world. Maybe that's our job. Maybe we're to be the good in the world. Through our generosity, through our kindness, through our love. Maybe others can see the hope, see the good in the world through us, what we do, how we act, how we talk, the actions that we take, and the good deeds that we might do. Maybe someone sees us putting away the shopping carts, and they'll say, oh, look at that person doing such good in the world. There is good in the world. There are so kind people. We know that, we hear that all the time. We hear a story of someone doing a good deed, we're shocked, we're surprised, right? Like, oh, someone was doing something good. Wow. Maybe that should be us. And so by believing there is good in the world, we can be the good that is the world. It can come through our generosity, our sacrifice, and then eventually our kindness and our love. And that's the type of world that God wants to see. The type of people that God